So, angular momentum is a concept that explains a lot of things, from why figure skaters spin faster when they pull their arms in to how planets maintain their orbits. And this topic is quite simple to understand because it can be very easily compared with its counterpart in linear motion, that is linear momentum. So, consider this particle with mass m moving through point A in the xy plane with velocity v. Then we can say that its linear momentum p is equal to the product of mass and velocity at that point. Now, if you're asked to find the angular momentum, often labeled as L, of this particle with respect to the origin O, it will be the cross product of position vector r and the linear momentum of the particle. And since it is a cross product, the angular momentum becomes a vector quantity. So, a couple of things to observe here are, one, r is the position vector of the particle with respect to origin O. Two, we always find angular momentum with respect to a point, and here it is the origin. So, stating that a particle has, let us say, 2 units of angular momentum is incomplete without specifying the reference point, such as point A, B, or X. Okay, so you can see that as the particle undergoes motion relative to O and in the direction of its momentum P, position vector R will tend to rotate around O. Now, make note that I am not saying that the particle will move around O. I said the position vector R will rotate around O. So, you see that for a particle to have angular momentum about O, it is not necessary for the particle to rotate around O. That is to say, the particle can keep moving in this direction, even in a straight line, but still you can define angular momentum of this particle about point O. Now, if you compare this equation to the torque equation, you will see that angular momentum bears the same relationship to linear momentum that torque does to force. That is, here we did a cross product of R with linear force F, and here we did a cross product of R with linear momentum P. Now, whenever we have a cross product defining a quantity, we have to define the direction of the quantity as well. And to find the direction of the angular momentum vector L, we go through the usual drill. That is, we slide vector P to the origin without changing its direction. And then we use the right hand rule, that is, sweep the palm of the right hand from R, which is the first vector in this equation, towards vector P, and what we find is that the thumb then gives the direction of L. And here it is in the positive direction of the z-axis. And you see, this positive direction is also consistent with the fact that the position vector R is moving in counterclockwise direction about the z-axis, in which case we assign a positive sign. And if the position vector was moving in clockwise direction, L would have been negative. Now, the magnitude of angular momentum would be Rmv sine phi. And this equation tells us that magnitude of angular momentum depends not only on R, M, or V, but also on the angle phi. So, if an object moves directly towards or away from the origin, phi becomes zero and its angular momentum also becomes zero. And as we learned in the previous lesson on torque, we can rewrite this equation in two more forms. And these are, one, L is equal to Rp perpendicular, which is equal to Rmv perpendicular, where P perpendicular is a component of linear momentum P perpendicular to R, and V perpendicular is the component of V also perpendicular to R. And the second way this equation can be written as is L is equal to R perpendicular times P, which equals R perpendicular times MV. And here R perpendicular is the distance between O and the extension of vector P. So these formulations can provide different perspective and may simplify calculations depending on the specific problem. Okay, this may sound confusing when you try to understand it the first time. So to speed up your understanding, I would suggest that you go through the lesson on torque, which is the previous lesson, and I put the link in the description as well and also in the comments. So now we are ready to understand Newton's second law in its angular form. So Newton's second law, written in its linear form, is F net is equal to dP upon dt, or the rate of change of linear momentum. And we know that it is an expression of the relation between force and linear momentum for a particle. So drawing a parallel with this equation, we can say that torque net is equal to dL upon dt, or the rate of change of angular momentum instead of linear momentum. So this is Newton's second law for a particle in its angular form. And more formally, we can say that the vector sum of all the torques acting on a particle is equal to the rate of change of the angular momentum of that particle. So it tells us that just like force changes linear momentum, torque changes angular momentum. Again, remember that this equation is valid or will make sense only if the torque and the angular momentum are defined with respect to the same point, which quite often is the origin in a coordinate system that is being used. So if you found this lesson helpful, please give it a thumbs up. And for a deeper understanding of rotation, angular variables and rolling motion, do check out the playlist linked in the description, and I will see you in the next video.